The Robe by Lloyd C. Douglas. This book is read by Stuart Langton. The Robe, Chapter 1. Because she was only 15, and busy with her growing up, Lucia's periods of reflection were brief and infrequent, but this morning she felt weighted with responsibility. Last night her mother, who rarely talked to her about anything more perplexing than the advantages of clean hands and a pure heart, had privately discussed the possible outcome of father's reckless remarks yesterday in the Senate, and Lucia, flattered by this confidence, had declared maturely that Prince Gaius wasn't in a position to do anything about it. But after she had gone to bed, Lucia began to fret. Gaius might indeed overlook her father's heated comments about the extravagances and mismanagement of his government, if he had had no previous occasion for grievance against the Gallio family. There was, however, another grievance that no one knew about except herself, and Diana. They would all have to be careful now, or they might get into serious trouble. The birds had awakened her early. She was not yet used to their flutterings and twitterings, for they had returned much sooner than usual, spring having arrived and unpacked before February's lease was up. Lucia roused to a consciousness of the fret that she had taken to bed with her. It was still there, like a toothache. Dressing quietly so as not to disturb Tertia, who was soundly sleeping in the alcove, and would be alarmed when she roused to find her mistress's couch vacant, Lucia slipped her sandals softly over the exquisitely wrought mosaics that led from her bedchamber and through her parlour into the long corridor, and down the wide stairway to the spacious hall, and out into the vast peristyle, where she paused, shielding her eyes against the sun. For the past year or more, Lucia had been acutely conscious of her increasing height and rapid development into womanhood. But here, on this expanse of tessellated tiling, she always felt very insignificant. Everything in this immense peristyle dwarfed her. The tall marble columns that supported the vaulted roofs, the stately statues standing in their silent dignity on the close-clipped lawn, the high silver spray of the fountain. No matter how old she became, she would be ever a child here. Nor did it make her feel any more mature when, proceeding along the patterned pavement, she passed Servius, whose face had been bronzed and deep-lined when Lucia was a mere toddler. Acknowledging with twinkling fingers and a smile the old slave's grave salute, as he brought the shaft of his spear to his wrinkled forehead, she moved on to the vine-covered pergola at the far end of the rectangle. There, with her folded arms resting on the marble balustrade that overlooked the terraced gardens, the arbours, the tiled pool, and commanded a breathtaking view of the city and the river, Lucia tried to decide whether to tell Marcellus. He would be terrifically angry, of course, and if he did anything about it at all, he might make matters worse. But somebody in the family must be informed where we stood in the opinion of Gaius before any more risks were taken. It was unlikely, thought Lucia, that she would have an opportunity to talk alone with her brother until later in the day, for Marcellus had been out, probably all night, at the military tribune's banquet, and wouldn't be up before noon. But she must resolve at once upon a course of action. She wished now that she had told Marcellus last summer when it had happened. The soft whisper of saddle straps made her turn about. Decimus, the butler, was approaching, followed by the Macedonian twins, bearing silver trays aloft on their outspread palms. Would his mistress, inquired Decimus, with a deep bow, desire her breakfast served here? Why not? Said Lucia absently. Decimus barked at the twins, and they made haste to prepare the table, while Lucia watched their graceful movements with amused curiosity, as if observing the antics of a pair of playful terriers. Pretty things they were. A little older than she, though not so tall, agile and shapely, and as nearly alike as two peas. It was the first time that Lucia had seen them in action, for they had been purchased only a week ago. Apparently Decimus, who had been training them, thought they were ready now for active duty. It would be interesting to see how they performed. For father said they had been brought up in a home of refinement and were probably having their first experience of serving a table. Without risking an inquiring glance at the young woman who stood watching them, they proceeded.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.